In the previous videos, we have studied wave propagation inside ferrite medium, where the direction of the propagation is the same as the direction of the DC biasing magnetic field. The question now is, what will be the situation if the propagation constant, or the propagation direction is transverse to the DC biasing magnetic field? This is actually case 2 for plane wave propagation in ferrite medium. Case 2 is propagation transverse to the bias. And if we remember, case 1 was propagation along the direction of the bias, and we call that this case is Faraday rotation. For case 2, where the propagation is transverse to the bias, we are going to call this case as birefringence case, and we will see why we are calling this case by birefringence case. We are not going to change the direction of propagation. The direction of propagation would be the same, it would be in Z direction, but we are going to change the direction of DC biasing magnetic field. So, assuming that the DC biasing magnetic field in the present case in X direction, so the corresponding permeability tensor for the ferrite medium when it is biased by X directed biasing magnetic field, it would be mu naught in X direction and mu in Y direction plus J kappa in YZ direction minus J kappa in ZY direction and mu in ZZ direction. This is the permeability tensor for X biased magnetic field, by X biased ferrite medium. Now, the plane wave inside the ferrite medium is assumed to be propagating in Z direction. So, for the electric field, it would be E naught multiplied by e to the power minus j beta Z, where E naught here is X or Y components. So E naught is either X or Y, and the corresponding magnetic field H could be H naught multiplied by the propagation constant E to the power minus J beta Z. Effectively, we have HX and HY, and as we will see, we also have HZ in this case. But at least for conventional plane wave, we have HX and HY. And because we are talking about plane wave, so the derivative with respect to X and the derivative with respect to Y would be zero, because the magnitude of the field in the XY plane should be constant. So partial by partial X equals partial by partial Y equals zero, while partial by partial Z corresponds to multiplication by minus J beta Z. Okay, and we are going to assume that there is no Z component for the electric field, so Ez equals zero. And according to Maxwell's equation, curl E, it would be minus J omega multiplied by the permeability tensor mu multiplied by the magnetic field H, and curl H, it would be J omega epsilon E. Okay, so we are going to use this tensor matrix here to obtain the X component, Y component, and Z component from this curl operation. And we are going to replace any partial by partial X or partial by partial Y by zero, and any partial by partial Z, it would be J beta. So doing these steps, we can obtain the X component, it would be minus partial EY by partial Z, it would be J beta multiplied by EY. This X component would correspond in this case, according to this tensor, minus J omega mu naught HX. And for the case of the Y component, it would be partial EX by partial Z, so it would be minus J beta multiplied by EX. This will correspond to the Y component from here. The Y component from here would be minus J omega multiplied by mu multiplied by hy plus j kappa multiplied by hz. Mu hy plus j kappa z. Finally, the z component, it would depend on partial by partial x plus partial by partial y, so it would be 0 here, would correspond to the z component here. And as I said, here we are assuming there is hz, so it would be minus j kappa hy plus mu hz, minus j kappa hy plus mu hz. This should be 0. On the other hand, for curl h equals j omega epsilon e, this can be simply obtained as j beta multiplied by hy equals j omega epsilon ex. This is the x component. For the y component, would be minus j beta hx would equal j omega epsilon ey. And finally, the z component, 0, would be j omega epsilon ez. So, as we are expecting, the longitudinal component of ez is 0. So, there is no longitudinal component for the electric field. We have only ex and ey. Okay? So, this is actually the extraction of Maxwell's equations for the case of plane wave propagating transverse to the biasing direction. From this extraction of Maxwell's equation, we can say that from this first equation, we have j beta ey equals minus j omega mu naught hx, and hx, it can be replaced by omega epsilon over minus beta multiplied by ey. So by arranging hx with its equivalent for ey, we can say that beta squared ey equals omega mu naught epsilon, omega squared mu naught epsilon ey. So the relation of ey would be simply given by this equation. In the same way, we can obtain the relation for ex. Here ex is a function of hy and hz. Hy, it can be replaced by omega epsilon over beta multiplied by ex. So this is hy. Hz, effectively hz, it can be obtained in terms of hy, because minus j kappa hy plus mu hz equals 0. So, in this case, we can say that hz equals kappa or j kappa over mu hy. So, if we know hy in terms of ex, we can obtain hz in terms of ex too. By doing this, we can obtain a relation for ex only. We are going to replace hy as a function of ex and hz as a function of ex. So, this relation would be a relation of ex only. By doing this, we can obtain this relation, mu multiplied by beta squared minus omega squared mu epsilon, and it should be noted here, mu is not mu naught, it is the mu of this tensor. So, mu multiplied by beta squared minus omega squared mu epsilon multiplied by ex equals minus omega squared epsilon kappa squared ex. So this is the corresponding wave equation for the ex component. Okay. It is interesting to note that we have a wave equation for the ey component and another wave equation for the ex component. Effectively, this is what is known as birefringence. Each polarization is propagating with a different propagation constant. This is the relation that we have obtained. So, assuming that the value of Ex is 0 and the polarization of the incident field, it was Ey, this means that we are propagating transverse to the biasing DC magnetic field. We are propagating in Z direction. And the polarization of the plane wave is also transverse to the biasing direction. The polarization is Ey. So everything now is transverse to biasing magnetic field. The propagation in Z and the electric field in Y, and the biasing DC magnetic field in X. Okay? In this case, this relation is 0 because we have EX0, EX0. The remaining part, it would be related to EY. So, assuming that the electric field E naught, it would be E naught in Y direction, multiplied by E to the power minus J beta naught Z. And beta naught here is a propagation constant. It would be, from this equation, beta squared, it would be omega squared mu naught epsilon. So, beta naught, it would be omega squared root mu epsilon. And the relation between the magnetic field and the electric field, it would be omega epsilon over beta naught, and according to the value of beta naught, it would be square root epsilon over mu naught, which is actually the intrinsic admittance of a medium with relative permeability, relative permittivity epsilon. So effectively, everything here is corresponding to a medium with relative permittivity epsilon, and permeability is mu naught. So we are going to call this polarization, or this type of wave, is ordinary wave, because everything is the same as if there is no ferrite material at all. It is a material with relative permittivity and permeability equals mu naught. So this is the ordinary wave. So we say that this wave is called the ordinary wave because it is unaffected by the magnetic properties of the ferrite. This happens when the magnetic field component is transverse to the bias direction are 0, such that Hy equal Hz equal 0. So we have the magnetic field of the RF signal in this case, Hy and Hz are 0, and we have just Hx in the same direction of the biasing for the magnetic field. So this happens whenever the magnetic field component transverse to the bias direction are 0. The wave propagation is either positive or negative direction with the same propagation constant. So the value of beta is not affected by if I'm propagating in positive Z or in negative Z, which is independent on the value of H naught. Okay? So in the ordinary wave, effectively I'm talking about a dielectric slab with permittivity epsilon. Alright? On the other hand, the extraordinary wave, when the polarization, the direction of the electric field would be at the same direction of the biasing DC magnetic field. In this case, the value of the propagation constant be extraordinary, it would be omega square root mu extraordinary multiplied by epsilon. And mu extraordinary in this case would be mu squared minus gamma squared over mu. How it comes? Effectively, I'm going to multiply this mu here and here, and I'm going to move this term to the other side. So it would be omega squared mu squared epsilon minus omega squared epsilon gamma squared. And here it would be mu beta squared EX. So I'm going to divide by mu to make or to take the value of beta. So beta squared, it would be omega squared multiplied by epsilon multiplied by mu squared minus gamma squared over mu, which is a extraordinary permeability. In this case, the intrinsic impedance of the medium would be the extraordinary extrinsic impedance, the value of Hy over Ex in this case, it would be omega epsilon over beta E, which is equal to square root of epsilon over mu extraordinary. And effectively, this mu extraordinary here, it is not the value of mu naught, it is not it depends on H naught or the biasing magnetic field, because mu and gamma depends on the biasing magnetic field. So note that this effective permeability also may be negative for certain value of omega and omega naught, because if the value of gamma is greater than mu, so the effective or the extraordinary permeability, in this case it would be negative value. And if mu is negative value, this means that the propagation constant, it would be imaginary part or G alpha. So in other words, it would be completely attenuation and there is no propagation in this case. Okay, for the extraordinary wave, as I said, J beta HY equal J omega epsilon EX. So HY, it can be obtained from EX by omega over omega epsilon over beta, which is the admittance, extraordinary admittance. And HZ is related to HY, such that HZ equals kappa over mu multiplied by HY. So in this case, the extraordinary magnetic field, it would include a Y component, and this Y component is effectively the magnitude of the electric field multiplied by the intrinsic admittance of the extraordinary medium, plus HZ component, and this HZ component is J kappa over mu of this HY. So the magnitude of the Z component is J kappa over mu of the magnitude of the Y component. So in the case of extraordinary wave, it is not a pure transverse electromagnetic wave, because here we have a longitudinal component for the magnetic field. We have a Z component for the magnetic field. But even so, if we are looking for the direction of the electric field and the direction of the magnetic field, it is a linear polarized plane wave. It is not a circular polarized wave. So it is a linear polarized wave propagating in positive Z direction, but in addition, we have a longitudinal component for the magnetic field HZ. Alright? This is the types of or the characteristics of extraordinary wave. According to this, we can note that the properties of the wave propagation in transverse to the biasing magnetic field depends on the polarization of the field. If the polarization is transverse to the biasing magnetic field, it would be ordinary. If the polarization in the same direction of the biasing field, it would be extraordinary. So we have different propagation constant according to the polarization of the plane wave in this case. These fields constitute a linear polarized wave, but note that the magnetic field has a component in direction of propagation. That's what I'm talking about, the extraordinary. Except for the existence of HZ, the extraordinary wave has an electric and magnetic field that are perpendicular to the corresponding fields of the ordinary plane wave. Thus, a wave polarized in y direction will propagate, will have propagation constant beta naught ordinary, but a wave propagate in x direction will have a propagation constant beta extraordinary. This different propagation constant for different polarization, it means that, or is effectively, this effect where the propagation constant depends on the polarization direction is called birefringence effect. That's why when electromagnetic waves are propagating in transverse direction to the biasing DC magnetic field, the effect in this case is the birefringence effect. Once again, to remember, when the wave it was propagating in the same direction of the biasing magnetic field, the effect it was Faraday rotation. Alright? The effective permeability, or the extraordinary permeability, can be negative if the value of kappa squared is greater than mu squared. And as I said, this condition depends on the value of the operating frequency omega, and Larmor frequency omega naught, and the magnetization frequency omega m. And effectively, Larmor frequency omega naught depends on the DC biasing magnetic field H naught. The omega, it depends on the operating frequency. The magnetization frequency depends on the saturation magnetization of the material. So we can say that it depends on omega, omega naught, omega m, or it depends on the frequency H naught, or saturation magnetization. For fixed frequency and saturation magnetization, if we fixing AF and MS, there will be always some range for biasing magnetic field where mu extraordinary or mu effective is negative. So we can adjust the value of the biasing DC magnetic field to introduce mu effective negative or mu extraordinary negative. In this range, the propagation constant, when this occurs, beta extraordinary will become pure imaginary, which implies that the wave will be cut off, it will be completely alpha, it is not beta, or evanescent waves. So, an X polarized plane wave instant at the interface of such ferrite media in vision would be totally reflected in this case. Once again, we can use this property in designing what we are calling isolator, such that the X polarized wave will be prevented from propagating around the ferrite medium, while the Y polarized wave will be allowed to be propagating in the ferrite medium. So we can prevent some wave from propagation while allowing another polarization to be propagating. By appropriate design, we can make the forward direction in Y polarization, while the backward wave in X polarization, which it be prevented. So we are allowing the wave to going from port 1 to port 2 and preventing the wave to go from port 2 to port 1. And this is a basic idea of what we are calling isolator. We are going to study the isolator in more detail, but at least now we know that the Y polarization or the polarization normal to the biasing direction will not have extraordinary propagation constant, so it will propagate. However, the polarization parallel to the biasing magnetic field will have extraordinary propagation constant, which may be imaginary, and at certain frequency or for certain biasing magnetic field, it would be completely stopped or completely evanescent. As an example for this, here we show an example for the extraordinary permeability mu effective over mu naught as a function of the applied DC magnetic field H naught in arrested for different frequencies. So by increasing the applied magnetic field, we can note that the curve of the mu extraordinary will be extended more here by applying H naught, by increasing H naught. We can note that the effective permeability will go from positive to negative value. It is positive at lower frequency and negative at higher frequency. So at these higher frequencies, the effective permeability would be negative and it would be evanescent for the polarization barrel to the direction of H. Actually, this behavior is going to be resonant, and after a higher value of H naught, it will be returned back to be positive once again. So, for example, at frequency 6 GHz, for different values of saturation magnetization, we have this is a value of M effective over mu naught, mu effective over mu naught. And after a large value of H naught, we can note that this effective permeability returns back to be positive. So in this range, it would be stop band. In this range, it would be pass band. Okay. For higher frequencies, we can note that this curve is shifted up. So the lower band or the evanescent band will appear at a higher value of H naught. This is briefly the behavior of the extraordinary permeability as a function of the frequency and the saturation magnetization and the different values for the applied DC magnetic field. Okay, all right.